needs to be explained to the world how it happens that a man like George Bush is president of the United States, and that a government that surrounds him, that works with him and for him, is such a danger to humanity. It needs to be explained because most of the people in the world are not going to be able to cope with or deal with the problem presented by George Bush. They will not be able to believe what they are seeing as each war comes down the pike. The next war may be Brazil or India. Maybe after that, Russia and China. They're not going to believe it as it happens to them. They're not going to believe what they see in front of their faces until, perhaps, they are given some evidence to explain what is this? What is George Bush? This is not simply a politician. What are we dealing with here? What I would ask you to do while I'm presenting this material is to try to forget certain kinds of things you may have learned in school. Try to forget left wing and right wing. Try to forget certain things about religion. You can remember God, but try to forget certain things that you might have learned in a university or some other place about these subjects. Maybe you could remember certain facts about World War II and forget some other facts, and then let us analyze certain things together. I'm asking you to have an open mind, be curious, be skeptical, but remember that there are many things that we don't know, and you'll never learn anything unless you have that attitude, that most of what we need to know, we don't know yet. That's what we have to start with. And our objective has to be, how can we work in time to prevent this awful danger from doing irreparable harm to humanity? The material that I'm going to present is the subject of intensive research that's now going on. It has never before been presented to the public in any form. And there are some very obvious reasons for that, as you'll see. In 1942, while the United States was engaged in World War II, the United States government, under the authority of the Trading with the Enemy Act, issued several orders seizing institutions in the United States, seizing property that was owned by Nazis and fascists in Europe. One of the important organizations that the United States government seized and closed was called the Union Banking Corporation, located at 39 Broadway, New York City. Prescott S. Bush, the father of President George Bush, was at that time a director and on paper an owner of the Union Banking Corporation. And as the government pointed out in its investigatory report on the Union Banking Corporation, Mr. Bush Sr. and others in this organization were only holding their shares in this bank on behalf of the real owners, the Thyssen family of Nazi Germany. This bank was the New York banking organization for what was known as the German Steel Trust throughout the period of the Hitler dictatorship until the United States government closed it down and took away Mr. Bush's property. Another organization that was seized was called the Hamburg America Line, a steamship company, which in the 1920s and early 30s was the largest private steamship company in the world. I have the order numbers and the dates that the government seized these organizations, seized the property. Another one was called Silesian American Corporation. All of these were Nazi-owned companies that the Bush family was deeply, deeply involved in. In fact, the family of President George Bush made their money principally in the development of the Hitler government in Germany, in promoting that government into power, in running the industries that developed the weaponry for Hitler's army, and also, although you can't say they made their money this way, playing an important role in promoting the racialistic philosophy and propaganda, shall we say, it's not philosophy, that was used by the Nazis in the 1930s and 1940s. That's the background of the Bush family. I'm going to do this in a very systematic way. What I want to do is put up was a man from St. Louis named George Herbert Walker. He was the son of a dry goods merchant, and Mr. Walker was educated in England and developed relationships to certain English aristocrats and got interested in horse racing and good breeding of people and horses. And he became very intimate with the J.P. Morgan banking organization. We'll go into that in a bit. He had a daughter named Dorothy Walker, and a son named George H. Walker Jr. Dorothy Walker married Prescott Bush, the father of the president. So Prescott and Dorothy Walker Bush had a son, the president of the United States. And his name is George Herbert Walker Bush, and he's named after George Herbert Walker, his grandfather, his mother's father. You can follow this chart by looking at the lines going down, which indicate children, and this squiggly line indicates a marriage. Prescott Bush and Dorothy Walker had, we'll mention these two children, George Bush, the president, and his brother, Prescott Bush Jr. He's recently been in the news for some rather strange operations in China and Japan. Maybe they were illegal. I haven't followed them very closely. Barbara Bush, the wife of the president, was originally named Barbara Pierce. She is supposed to be a descendant of the Pierce family of President Franklin Pierce, who I think was a rather poor president. And I wrote a few things about him in the book back there. But you can't blame the descendants for their ancestors. And people, whenever I say something about George Bush, people always say, "But I like Barbara." You know, which is largely irrelevant to anything. Whether you like somebody, don't like them, that's hardly the point. Barbara Bush, Barbara Pierce, has a brother named Scott Pierce. He was president of the E.F. Hutton brokerage house in the United States. And while he was president, they got pretty famous for laundering dope money. It was called the Pizza Connection. And they pleaded guilty to 2,000 felony counts of money laundering. But of course, he never went to jail. And he actually stayed in office as president for quite a long time of that company. He was formerly in the George H. Walker brokerage firm, started by Grandpa up here. you know, the Bush grandfather. So he was rather well connected. George Bush, the president, and his wife Barbara have, I have three of their sons up here. I don't remember how many there are, but these are three of them. One of them is named John Ellis Bush, Jeb for short. He's a political operative working in Latin America and Miami, Florida, with the Contras during the recent adventures. He's been a business partner of narcotics racketeers in Miami. He got into some trouble for that. His bank went bankrupt for that reason down there. But he's been very handy for George Bush on relations with Latin American political organizations. Then there's George Bush Jr., who has an organization in Texas specializing in massive investments in the Soviet Union and China. Finally, we'll mention Neil Mallon Bush, who was involved in quite a bit of loan fraud, and he was scheduled to have dinner one night with a man named John Hinckley Jr., his close friend. But unfortunately, I think the night before the dinner, John Hinckley Jr. shot President Reagan, and so they had to call off the dinner. So his dad had to wait a while because Reagan recovered. Yes. The same people that you know about, as we talk about Adolf Hitler and other subjects, that yes, these are the very same people that today are running in and out of the White House. Not some other group. Not some other Bush, maybe it's a mistake, it's a name mistake or something. No, it's the same people. E.H. Harriman, Edward Henry Harriman. He married a woman named Mary Averill, the daughter of a rich railroad owner. And they had at least four children, the ones I'm interested in here. They were named E. Roland Harriman, who was called Bunny by his friends, very close friend of Prescott Bush. And then another son was named William Averill Harriman, and he was called Averill for his nickname, it's his middle name. He's a very famous man, Averill Harriman. He was ambassador to Russia in World War II, governor of New York, and primarily a banker. He had a sister named Mary. She married somebody named Rumsey. And another member of the Rumsey family, in fact, the man who controlled the Rumsey family's entire money, was a relative named William J. Donovan, otherwise known as Wild Bill Donovan. He was the director of the first Central Intelligence Agency. He set up the U.S. spy system during World War II, working with British intelligence, and under their direction, and under their model, and under their control. Mr. Harriman was very much in love with just about anything British. So it was a nice match. Then there was another sister named Cordelia. She married somebody in the Elbridge Gerry family. It's an old American name. Again, you can't blame the person she married for their ancestor. The ancestor was a lot better than he was. But one of their relatives in the Gerry family, a very close relative, was named William Stamps Farish. And he's very closely connected to a place called Auschwitz. We'll get to that a little later. This is the Harriman family, very important family in American history in the 20th century. He called the Hitler Project. When you talk about World War II, when you think about it, before I put this up, I want to distract you. We often think of the results of World War II rather than the origins. We often think of what the Nazis did, rather than who they were and where they came from. We often think of what happened from them rather than what was done all over the world on both sides in World War II. Many of these things are quite interesting. One thing that is almost never discussed, certainly not in public schools or in today's media, is how is it that Hitler and the Nazis became in control of Germany? Something like the question of how the South was brought to secede from the Union. It was a similar question. Often the question is answered, well, those people are like that. Southerners want to secede from the Union, which doesn't pay any attention to the fact that there was an actual political movement whose objective was to try to break up the United States. And they were pretty radical people, and they were in opposition to most of the other people for most of the time until they got the right circumstances to get the big crisis and break up the country. Not all the slave owners wanted to secede, for example. Same thing over in Germany. More so, because in Germany, like any other country in Europe, is part of the international community. And you had a republic in the 1920s. In 1933, Hitler and his thugs took over that country. How'd that happen? Well, some people after the war said, well, this is because Germans are like that. Some of the people who said that played a very interesting role in bringing the result of that. The most powerful banker in the world, in the period before World War II, was named Montague Norman. Montague Cullet Norman. He was the governor of the Bank of England from 1920 until 1944. His grandfather had also been governor of the Bank of England. And they were part of a family firm called Brown Brothers. So Mr. Norman was the leading sponsor in parts of the world outside of Germany of Adolf Hitler. He was rather a fanatic on the subject. Just about everything he did for a period of 2 years leading up to Hitler's taking power was to arrange for Hitler and his thugs to seize power in Germany. Now remember, he's an Englishman. And he's the head of the Bank of England. And in a certain way, the head of world banking. He had allies that he worked very closely with in different countries. I'll mention the ones in Britain first. The Morgan Bank, which in England is called Morgan Grenfell. The partner, the head partner, was his old friend Teddy Grenfell, who used to be in the Brown Brothers firm with him. Another bank was called J. Henry Schroeder Bank. Two of the partners in that, Mr. Tjarks and Baron Bruno Schroeder, were both in the Bank of England as well. And this is a German name. You can remember that, right? Schroeder. And that bank was in, that banking family was in Germany and England and the United States, very handy. Brown Shipley was the English name for the Brown Brothers. Brown Brothers is one of these investment banks. That is, it's a group of people that close the door and make plans. Most of them bring a lot of grief, frankly. They don't build things usually. This particular company, Brown Brothers, operated in England and America, and they ran most of the cotton from the slave south into England. 75% of all slave cotton that was exported from the United States went out on their boats and through their credit. In fact, they controlled a lot of the slave owners directly. They had them in hock. You know what a slave owner is, right? He's a guy that sits on the porch and thinks he's a powerful man because he can kick somebody below him. But he's in debt. And there's a banker sitting off in London who's got a whole little empire that involves this thing. That's the Brown Brothers Company. Then there's a company called Vickers. They make battleships, machine guns, bombs, and the Bank of England and Norman organized that bank, reorganized that company, and started selling machine guns and tanks to the Nazis during the 1930s. All of these banks and companies were involved in supporting Hitler, supporting the movement to put Hitler into power. In Germany, the most important ally of Montague Norman was a man named Hjalmar Schacht, the head of the Reichsbank, the German National Bank. Hjalmar Schacht directly reported to Montague Norman all the time. He went to stay at his house, Thorpe Lodge, near London. And they would meet about once a month, all throughout the time leading up to Hitler's takeover and beyond, for years and years and years. And Montague Norman and Hjalmar Schacht would plan the budget for Nazi Germany together. Another person in Germany that was very important to this banking empire was named Kurt von Schroeder in this family, Schroeder family. He was a delegate from Germany to the Bank for International Settlements. He used to go between Germany and Switzerland. And a lot of these guys would meet in Switzerland to plan their shenanigans. He was also a general in the SS, Hitler's private army. And he was the treasurer for the SS support organization. So he collected the money to help promote a 300,000-man private army for Hitler, before Hitler was dictator. Right? Very important. And in the United States, and these are all of the intimate personal allies of Montague Norman. In the United States, of course, he had to go to see the New York Federal Reserve chief, Benjamin Strong, and the guy that succeeded him. At the J.P. Morgan firm, which is part of this British firm, the particular partner that he worked with was Thomas Lamont. In 1931, the Harriman family merged with the Brown Brothers Company, and they had this Brown Brothers Harriman firm. And his collaborator over in New York was named Thatcher Brown. And then finally, there's another New York bank named Schroeder Rockefeller. Another name for the same organization was J. Henry Schroeder Bank, just like in England. Among the partners of this Nazi organization were Alan Dulles, later the head of the Central Intelligence Agency, Kurt Schroeder, Bruno Schroeder, and Rudolf Schroeder. So, what I want to get you to have a sense of is that this is an international group. Some are German, some are English, some are American. What's their point of view? They do have a point of view. We'll get into that a little bit later. But they definitely have a point of view. They're not in it for the money. There's a crisis in the world. They're losing their money in the Depression. Stock crash, 1929. Banks starting to collapse. State and city governments not able to function. Boy, that sounds funny. They get a crisis. And they say, well, how will we solve this crisis? How about if we cut services? Shut down some unions. Cut off people, old people. How about if we get the public to start thinking in terms of killing some of these old people or sick people? Or what about Hitler? He's a tough guy. He's a big faker. You need somebody like that to accomplish that kind of, to be tough, right? As long as he's under control. Enter the
let's see. Yeah, you can just put some tape up there. That's fine. That's good. No. Just, all right. On this chart, which you can look at later and you can ask questions about, I don't expect you to memorize anything. I want you to try to get an idea of what was going on, because it's very different from what people have heard about. In 1919, at the end of World War I, this guy from St. Louis, George Herbert Walker, set up a bank. It was called W.A. Harriman and Company. It was set up because this guy, Averill Harriman, came out here to St. Louis and said, would you please set up a bank for me? I know you're connected to people even more powerful than I am. I only have $100 million in my family. I know you're connected to $1 billion. And we're going to do some big things. And in fact, the guys that I want you to get the money from authorized me to come out here. So Harriman, in a certain way, is not at the top of the totem pole. So George Herbert Walker moved to New York with a summer home in Kennebunkport, Maine, that his father had had. That's where the Bush family got their house. Because his dad had that home over there from a long time, from the 1800s, almost from slavery days. George Herbert Walker became the president of this bank and the founder of it. And his son-in-law, Prescott Bush, became the vice president of the bank. Averill Harriman went off to Berlin, and this bank now had offices in New York and Berlin by 1922. Now, when did Hitler take over Germany? 1933. Ooh, they're in there a long time before. 1922. Nobody ever heard of Nazis. In fact, you know when Adolf Hitler first got into the public notice? 1923. He staged a coup attempt. Right? It's called a putsch. Tried to take over the government. Pretty wild. It was financed by a man named Thyssen. He's a German steel manufacturer whose father and grandfather had actually built a good company. They had interesting, you know, innovations and technology like Andrew Carnegie. But unfortunately, just like Carnegie, their organization ended up in the hands of some pretty rotten people, and they were thinking more in terms of how to cut off the heads of uppity workers than they were about how to make some new steelmaking equipment. So, but this Fritz Thyssen gave money to Hitler back in 1923. Now, interestingly enough, Fritz Thyssen had a bank in New York City. In 1931, as the Depression started, this W.A. Harriman Bank merged with Brown Brothers, the old slavery days banking firm, because they were out of money. And these guys had a lot of money. So they merged, and they set up what was called Brown Brothers Harriman, which today is one of the biggest banks in the world. It's a private investment bank, which means they don't have to file a report with the government about what they do. They have a skyscraper in New York, their own skyscraper. And it's run by partners, not by stockholders. And they meet in a very fancy room and they plan what they're going to do with one country or another. Thatcher Brown was a senior partner of that. Old friend, possibly dead mate of Montague Norman. And Prescott Bush, after this merger, became senior manager.